and welcome. I am Shane Moore, and this is the Texasist Live. Tonight we're going to have a special episode about the coronavirus pandemic and how it is affecting the world as we speak. There is so many questions, and seemingly not a lot of answers. So just kick back, relax, and feel free to take part in our live chat and ask any question that you want to ask, make any comments you want to make. And if you've had any personal experiences, such as from grocery stores not being stocked, to roadblocks, seeing military build up or convoys or whatever in your town or your state, please feel free to chime in. I'm going to take a short break, and I will come back. This is I have some information that I came across getting ready for this special, and it's amazing how this type of thing or series of things, they always have the same pattern. And one thing that I've learned in 51 years is patterns never lie. Patterns never lie. Just like numbers never lie. When you have repeating patterns, it's pretty much you can take that to the bank. So I'll take a short break. I will be back in 3 minutes. That'll give you time to get something to drink, maybe get a snack, and get ready, because this is going to be pedal to the metal, no holding back. And hey, I'm not being dramatic. This is volatile information, and as I speak, I guarantee you there are measures being taken. There are measures being taken for anyone that is even whispering this. But my motto is on this podcast is, I talk about things that others are afraid to whisper. Is this big? This is huge. Could this be my last broadcast? Absolutely. Am I going to keep quiet? Absolutely not. I haven't in 51 years, and I don't intend to start now. So, Get ready, because this is going to be a doozy. I'll be back. Hello, Nazreen. Hello, Jacob. Hello, Patricia. Thank you so much for joining. I'll be back in 3 minutes.
Get no luck, yeah, 'cause with you it's trouble, trouble. Try to set you free.
Just gonna lay it out here. I mean, I don't have a lot of notes. I'm just gonna be going just as I go. So, and I want you to do the same thing. Just feel free to ask, share how you feel, because this is. This is, in my opinion, this is the greatest threat that we have ever faced. And I'm talking about not just the United States, but the world, humanity, if you will. I mean, in my lifetime, this is huge. And before I... you know, let you in on which you might already know, but I didn't, and I pore over the news, I pore over everything, especially when it's a, you know, a world crisis like it is now. And there's many questions that I have, and number one is, well, just to kind of give you a backstory to you, what I'm going to share is, I read about a week ago that there was a man in China that had the coronavirus, and he purposefully went to every bar, every club that he could possibly go to, and his reason was to spread the virus. Now, this man obviously had it, and he did spread it. But my question is how did he know that it was so contagious? This man worked in the markets there. I mean, he was not a, you know, someone that was in that we know of, that was in, you know, any biological warfare, or he was just a, I guess you could say, just a carrier. You know, he was infected, and there was no real measures, I don't think, that I've read, to try and help this man. But it's really strange, because no one wakes up one morning and says, "Wow, I have the flu," because a lot of people that you know start having symptoms of the coronavirus, they say, "Hey, I've got the flu," or "I've got an upper respiratory infection," you know, and then it gets bad, and they later find out that they've got the coronavirus. Okay, this man did not, in my opinion, did not just wake up one morning and say, "Wow, I can't believe the people I'm going to infect," and then die. You know, it's like most people would be seeking a hospital, or would be seeking treatment, and I believe that everyone would agree with that, versus going out and spreading this very contagious disease, virus, and thus increasing the rate. And lo and behold, now it's a pandemic, you know. So what was his reasoning? I mean, there's, you know, no one just does anything. There's always a catalyst. There's always something before people say, "I just did this," or "I just did that." When I'm talking to them, you know, when they contact me to talk about their problems, or for, you know, possible solution or help in their life, so many say, "I just did this," or "I just did that." And I say, "No, you didn't just. What happened before?" And they're like, "Wow, okay, this is what happened." And usually that's the answer to pinpointing, that's the beginning of pinpointing their problem. And when you know the problem, then you can deal with finding the solution. So this man did not just go out and infect people. My question my theory is, and this is just my opinion, you can agree with me or disagree with me, it's not going to hurt my feelings or make me think any different of you, but I believe that this man was given orders. I believe that he was ordered, or he was told, to spread it. To, you know, hey, kick this thing off. I mean, really, really get it rolling. And he did. I mean, you know, it's pretty simple. When you take into account that, again, he wasn't seeking medical attention. He wasn't in a hospital. He wasn't surrounded by doctors. He wasn't on oxygen. No, this dude's out, you know, acting like he's partying and everything, sneezing and coughing on everybody, probably with a wicked grin on his face, you know, thinking, wow, I'm doing what? Well, you know, you're actually doing nothing. I mean, you know, you're just, it's just very, very cowardly, very evil. I mean, I don't even have words for it. So that's my question is, you know, this one man. Now you take that into account and then ask yourself, okay, this was one man that they reported, that the, you know, mainstream media reported on. How many more were there that the mainstream media did not report on or did not know about? Nazreen, you say this also explains the video showing people spitting on elevators and coughing on people. Absolutely. Absolutely. And, you know, normal people, even crazy people, they don't spit and cough in people's faces. I mean, come on. When you see videos of people, you know, spitting on an elevator, what is that? That is a confined, closed, small space. You spit or you cough, you sneeze in an elevator without covering your nose, mouth, whatever. You sneeze in there, everyone in there is exposed and probably will, you know, yeah. Probably if their immune system is weakened or there is compromised, yeah, mission completed. I mean, you know. And then what about just 3 or 4 days ago, if that, the kids that were coughing on the produce here in the United States? I mean, they were coughing on, you know, coughing, I think, spitting or whatever, on the produce. And it's like, okay, did the kids have the virus? I don't know. But that's not the problem. The problem is they were coughing and spitting, or, you know, secreting bodily fluids, be it saliva, mucus, whatever, on produce. For what reason? To add to it. And I will address that, because there's something that we're not being told. Because this virus, this is different. You know, people say, well, the coronavirus has been around since the 1960s. Well, yes, a coronavirus, not this strain. This strain is like a pit bull that has been baptized in lemonade on steroids, and he's pissed. I mean, you know, Yeah, I mean, this and the speed at which this is being transmitted is accelerating by, oh, unbelievable. Well, it's believable, but in amounts of time. I mean, increased, like, nobody's business. I'm talking, you know, hundreds of new cases, and people say, well, it's because, you know, Florida, for example, there were hundreds of new cases within 24 hours that was, you know, diagnosed. People say, well, that's because they have the testing ability, you know, they receive tests. I don't really buy that. Just because you're not being tested and diagnosed doesn't mean that you're not falling out. You know, you're not falling down on your feet. And because when this hits you, it's not like the flu. It's very, very subtle in the beginning, and then bam, you know, it's crazy. Patricia, you say, do you know how old he was? I believe he was 34. There again, 34. Okay, they're saying, well, the people that are really the ones in danger are those over 60, or those with a immune system that's compromised, or, you know, this or that. Listen, there are people in their 30s that are dying from this. There was a 12-year-old girl that died from this, I think, 2 days ago. And to my knowledge, there was nothing wrong with her immune system. She got it. She died. And there again, I'm not on that. I mean, I didn't, you know, I didn't talk to the girl's parents, her family. I don't know the girl, her family. So I'm just going by her age. This there are healthy people below the age of 60 that are getting it, and they're dying. But what are we being told? We're being misled. We're being misled. Why? Well, because this is the perfect opportunity to really instill the fear-based propaganda. The, you know, keep the fear, instill the fear. They want us to be in a state of perpetual fear, but what they don't want is panic. When you're afraid, when you fear something, that's, you know, you're filled with anxiety, you're scared, but you still conform. You're still easily, most are still easily manipulated. Even more so when they're in that state of perpetual fear. But you take someone that panics, and guess what? Panic is not fear. When a person panics, a person does things that they would not normally do. And case in point, being an ex Golden Gloves boxer, I learned really, really quick that if you're fighting a, you know, guy, that that wants to fight, you know, you're probably going to, you know, come out unscathed, unmarked, no black eye, no broken nose or anything, which is, you know, great. I mean, but if you want to get hurt, if you really want to get hurt or possibly killed, corner someone or force someone to fight that's afraid to fight and they don't want to fight. And people say, well, never corner a coward. Well, I'm not going to call someone a coward, but I'm saying that when they're cornered, they have no way out, they panic. And what happens? They get out of the corner. They don't go through the wall, they go through you. And they will hurt you. Possibly kill you. And that's what the powers that be, I'm just going to say this right now, just to get it out of the way. The powers that be, I'm talking about the world GOV, okay? I'm not going to say certain words or whatever, because from what I have gathered, from what I've read, there are 24/7 on monitors on social media, especially social media. Be careful what you say or what you think or what you suspect or your theories on this being planned on social media, especially Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, whatever, because I'm telling you, they have algorithms that are in place that are recording, they are monitoring and reporting, and it is absolutely I guess you could say terrifying that they are talking about right now. They're talking about monitoring social media. You know, hey, this is waving goodbye to freedom of speech. This is, you know, they're saying, hey, look, if anybody, you know, gives their opinion on how they think that the powers that be somehow, for some reason, planned this and caused this, then, number one, their account or their channel will be possibly completely deleted, erased. You're gone. And they're even making suggestions or trying to pass certain laws, believe it or not, that if a person gives their opinion on how they think that this did not just happen, that it was planned and that it's part of a bigger picture. Many people have, you know, talked about is this the way that the New World Order that has been talked about for years and years and years, is this the time that it's going to be ushered in, and implemented. Well, you do the math on that. I'll say this. I have you know, studied this. I was, you know, studying the New World Order way before it was the New World Order. It was, you know, globalism, whatever, many different names. The great work, or, you know, which that applies to so many different things. I'm not talking about the esoteric great work. I'm talking about the global unity. And let me tell you, when you hear the word unity, don't just accept that as being good, because, you know, unity, world unity, that is not a good thing, believe it or not. I mean, unity with everyone, world unity, I mean, think about it. How does that work? Well, it works with you tolerating possibly very bad, very dangerous people. And so, for example, when I say this about the possible ushering in of the New World Order, people say, oh, he's like Alex Jones, which, please, I would rather you call me Pee Wee Herman than to call me Alex Jones, okay? I'm not Alex Jones. I'm not spreading fear. I mean, if you've listened to the show, I do all I can to lift people up, to encourage people, to give them confidence, you know, raise their self-esteem. Don't be afraid, you know. And I'm telling you now, don't be afraid. Don't let fear get the best of you, even in this. So I'm not spreading fear. I'm not spreading negativity. I'm just simply spreading what I believe is truth, possibly, and when we connect the dots, you can make up your own mind. I mean, I'm not gonna make up your mind for you, nor should I. But Nazarene, you say that they were spitting on the elevator buttons. Yes, probably doorknobs and many other things. I mean, wow, that's warfare right there. I mean, biological warfare. And let me see. Okay, let's see. Nazarene, you say the person in the video looked determined to do it without anyone seeing him do it. I guess it was surveillance cameras that caught him doing it. Yes, very, very creepy. And that, you know, that pretty much explains it. I mean, he looked determined to do it without anyone seeing him do it. Somebody spits, you know, spits a bunch of mucus on anything. Yeah. First of all, I'm not going to touch it. Secondly, I would probably confront them and ask them what their problem was, because that is after I puked, you know. I mean, would be, I mean, I don't handle things like, you know, mucus, and especially somebody doing it on purpose. I mean, good grief. So, Patricia, you say, this may be a different video, but I saw a video of a woman spitting on elevator buttons because she had an argument with a neighbor on a higher floor of her building. Thus her insistence to spit on things. Honestly, don't know why she did that exactly, but I know if the people who posted it were telling the truth about the behavior, okay? And, yeah, she sounds to me like that she was just very enraged, angry, and she just said, what the hell, you know? Probably in her mind she's saying, everyone's the same, everyone's against me, so, you know, it's crazy, I don't know. Jacob, you say the DOJ already is trying to take away our constitutional rights. Yes, they're trying to, they're making movements, moves to at least suspend our constitutional rights. Now, back to the new world order thing. In 1991, George H.W. Bush, then president, from the Oval Office, made his, you know, famous New World Order speech. Very creepy. Very creepy. I mean, his eyes were literally glistening, just glassy. He just was so excited. And I remember watching it live. I watch it on YouTube. Still gives me the creeps. I mean, I'm like, man, this guy, you know, is, I mean, something's not right. He says, and it was in his voice, is only, you know, he could creep you out with. He says, yes, he says, what we're talking about, what I'm talking about is a new world order. Yes. Not the rule of the jungle, but of peace and tolerance and, you know, respect and, you know, things like that. I'm not sure if that's the exact words that he used, but, yeah, it was that. And I'm thinking to myself, okay, what is he on? What's he smoking? What's he taking? Because it's like, I didn't get the memo that there was any plans to bring quote-unquote heaven to earth. I missed that memo. Because when something's too good to be true, guess what? It's not true. Somebody's, you know, pardon me, but somebody's pissing on your leg and they're telling you it's raining, you know. Yeah. It's not what it seems. And he's talking about, you know, not the rule of the jungle. And I'm thinking, okay, wow, have I been living under the rule of, have I been living under jungle laws? I mean, I don't think so. I mean, but he's definitely selling this idea of a utopia, you know. And then he goes on to say, you know, mention the 1,000 points of light. And his wife, Barbara, you know, she's, you know, they show her when he's making this, you know, speech or whatever, and she literally looks like she is hypnotized. I mean, her eyes, she doesn't blink, and she's just sitting there, and she's just captivated, like she is in some kind of out-of-body experience, ecstasy that, you know, I don't know, but creepy. Matter of fact, watch the video, And I'm not sure, but look at George H.W. Bush's eyes, how glassy they are. I mean, it's not normal. I mean, this guy was excited. He was just, like, ecstatic about this, you know. It was like he was saying one thing, but meaning, you know, totally something else. And he was trying, to me, he was trying not to erupt in just, you know, maniacal laughter, you know. Like, okay, I'm telling you this, and I know many of you are believing it, and I find that so hilarious. But he kept his composure because, what? He's a career politician, and many more things. Do your homework. I mean, was, you know, was George H.W. Bush, you know, someone that you wanted to have mad at you, or you know, on his list of enemies? Not him, no. Now his son, you know, his son, he, George W. Bush, he pretty much had glassy eyes, has had glassy eyes his entire life. So, and when he speaks most of the time, or when he did, didn't make much sense anyway. I mean, one just has to look at the fool me once, and, you know, fool me again, and he lost track. He couldn't, you know, tell a joke. I mean, and this guy was president for 8 years. Whoa. Crazy. Anyway, George H.W. Bush gave his New World Order speech. New World Order. Okay. My question is to you, what do you think the new is? And what do you think the order will be? Who is going to set up the order? Who's going to maintain the order of the New World Order? Just a question. But this is the kicker, okay? This is what really, really is telling, and very, very, I find very suspicious, if not absolutely beyond creepy, is he made that New World Order speech from the Oval Office on September 11th, 1991. That's right. 9/11/1991. That's a lot of ones and nines. Okay? Got that? If you want to, you might want to get a pen, piece of paper, write this down, just in case you want to go back and say, well, you know, that Shane, you know, that Texas guy, you know, he's making up a lot of, you know, a lot of conjecture, and, you know, no. Like I said, patterns don't lie. Let's see. Hold on just a second. Okay. He made his New World Order speech September 11th, 1991. Okay, just food for thought. The Pentagon. Yes, the Pentagon. The headquarters of the United States Defense broke ground on September 11th, 1941. September 11th, 1941. And then you come up to George H.W. Bush making his New World Order speech, and then you come up to 2001 and the Twin Towers, the hijacked planes, 9/11, almost 3,000 people died. Wow. Is that crazy? Well, it's definitely not sane, but the same date, the same numbers keep coming up. 9/11, ones and nines. Okay, the coronavirus is also known as COVID-19. What is that? Well, numerology, one is, of course, the beginning of the single digit numbers. Nine is the end. I mean, You have the beginning, and you have the end, or you have 1 through 9, which is the complete, you know, every number. And once you get out of the single digit numbers, every other number uses those numbers. So that's the foundation, and I just find it very strange that this is, you know, COVID-19, and it's I don't know, something to definitely think about. And what are we talking about as far as the enforcement of curfews, and if it does, I'm not saying it's going to happen. I'm saying there's a possibility of martial law. Who is going to enforce that? Well, wouldn't it be the military? What is the headquarters of the United States military? The Pentagon. And even if our military, they say, hey, look, you know, I'm not going to enforce anything on my own people, you know, that's fine, because guess what? Someone else will, and they'll be wearing blue caps. The United Nations. Yes, the United Nations. And if that happens, a United States soldier, or a soldier in your country, wherever you may live, chances are, if you are in quarantine and you leave or try to leave, chances are, if it's your own, you know, countrymen, you know, military, soldier, whatever, chances are he's not going to, or she's not going to, shoot you or, you know, stop you. But if it's someone else that's not your countryman, yeah, and they've been given orders to, you know, stop you any way they can, in my opinion, they would have no problem blowing your brains out, you know. And this is very frightening, because this is not something that you can check on, or, you know, you can't, you know, look up on, you know, Snopes is, you know, Johnny, does Johnny really have the coronavirus? You know, Snopes isn't going to tell you that. And, but I believe that the possibility exists that many people are going to be tested, and they're going to be told, hey, look, you have it. You're not showing any symptoms yet, or you're showing mild symptoms or whatever. We're going to take you in, put you in quarantine for, you know, a quarantine center, and for observation. Well, what if you don't have it? What if they have ulterior motives and they take you in and you find out it's something else and you never leave? Could it happen? Of course. This is what I'm talking about. This is the perfect way of not only manipulating, but taking, well, not taking. They won't take anything away from anyone. Well, maybe very few, but they won't take your guns. They want your guns. Trust me, they want your guns. They want everything. I mean, they, you know, what do men with power want? Not money, but power. They don't want money because they don't need it. They've already got enough money. But what do men with power want? What do people with power want? More power. More control. And this would be a perfect way of obtaining that. Why? Because people in a state of fear and maybe even panic pass anything away, for the simple reason that people in such a state of fear and possibly panic, they will willingly give them what they want. Now, we're talking, you know, so many. I think that that today the world infection, people infected, reached 300,000 people. That's huge. And with you know, people just openly terrified. I mean, look at your grocery store. I mean, look at how people are acting. I mean, how they're just going berserk. You know, they're going crazy. Fist fights over toilet paper. I mean, we're talking, you know. Yeah, they won't have to take anything from these people, because the people will willingly give them what they want. Why? Because, unfortunately, in this day and time, everyone is looking for someone to save them. Looking for someone to save them, to rescue them, you know. And people are going to be so afraid, in a state of fear and panic, that they'll be promised, yes, we can help you. We're working on a vaccine right now. And just, you know, give us your... I'm just going to use this as an example. Give us your guns, you know, because, you know, it would go something like this, you know, because of the pandemic and, you know, people are on edge. It would be best that you hand over your guns, and it would just be the best thing to do. And when you do, when... as soon as we find a vaccine, because you've done this, you'll be one of the first recipients of that vaccine. And, you know, guns, whatever it may be, your liberties, your rights, such as freedom of speech. Just like right now, if you put something on Facebook, if you put something on Twitter that is your opinion, your freedom of speech, but you're saying that this possibly could be a planned pandemic, that it was planned, and you know, you have the freedom to say what you want to say, but right now, the social media giants like Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, they are actually removing posts, they're removing channels, they're removing accounts of people that are posting opinions or what they're thinking, how they feel, if it is against the powers that be. Now, one thing, you can look this up, you can check it out. George Soros is really hounding YouTube to begin removing channels that are mentioning or that are talking about that this pandemic was planned. He's a proponent for ending the free speech on online, and I'm sure free speech anywhere else. Doesn't want it. Why? It's not good for him. It doesn't make money. You know, people, truth is frowned upon in this present time. Lies are eaten like candy. And what does he want? What is he afraid of? He's afraid of people knowing the truth. What truth? Well, you do the math. Why else would he be, you know, so determined, so adamant about, you know, yes, if someone posts, you know, something or their channel is about, you know, this and that, or is talking bad about me or powers that be, blah, 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 just delete that channel. take it down. And it's being done right now. There are, you know, people that have been on YouTube for years with hundreds of thousands of followers. Yeah, they're being booted, they're being erased, deleted. And even more than that, they're the powers that be, GOP, they're trying desperately to pass, to make it a law that depending on what a person posts about different thoughts or opinions against the powers that be, GOV, that not only is that person taken off of social media, but that person is arrested and taken into custody. Not kidding. No kidding. They are desperately trying to pass that so you won't be able to do what I'm doing now, which it's not even a law now, and I'm still putting my neck out by, you know, doing this, you know, saying this much. But back to the real issue. This is something that may shock some of you, if not most of you. But think about 9/11. 9/11. What happened on the morning of 9/11, besides 9/11? What was going on that day? That specific day, what was going on? What was going on was a military exercise dealing with what? Dealing with terrorism. And not just any type of terrorism. It was terrorism that of someone or a group hijacking a commercial airliner or airliners and flying them into skyscrapers, office buildings, you know. Which is why that when it really happened, so many of the responders were going, okay, kind of confused here. Is this part of the military exercise, or what's going on? You know, you can clearly understand how someone would be very, very confused, shocked beyond belief, because what are the chances that that's coincidence? Me, I don't believe in coincidence, and to me, it simply was not coincidence. There was more at work there. And the reason I say that is because when George W. Bush was at the school in Florida reading My Pet Goat to the children, he was informed that America was under attack. Okay, and that a commercial airliner had been hijacked and flown into the World Trade Center, you know, tower. What did he do? What did he do? He did nothing. He sat there with this look on his face. He was thinking something, right? And again, I'm not accusing him of anything. I don't have to. Watch it. Go to YouTube. Watch it. Look at his face. What's he doing? This is the president of the United States. Yes. The country's under attack. Okay, first question is, why did he not get up and leave that school immediately? Number one, he's the president. Okay, if the nation's under attack, the president is going to be the main target. You know, they're going to take out the president. They're going to want to take out the president. Number two is, if it had been me, I would have left because this was being, his location was, you know, was being told days and weeks before. It was being televised. I mean, everyone and their mother knew where the president of the United States was. He was in that elementary school. I would have left right then for fear that they would try to bomb me in the school. And here I am, you know, putting all these children at risk of being blown away. Yeah, I mean, I would have jumped up and I would have exited the building and went somewhere else. But he didn't. He sits there. And sits there and sits there for, I believe, like 17 minutes. It's only when he's informed the second plane has hit the second tower that he gets up and leaves with his, you know, Secret Service and his team. Okay? Now, what is the problem? What's the biggest thing about that? Biggest thing about that is if he had no idea what was taking place, he would have left when he was told the first plane hit the tower, country's under attack. And look, they wouldn't have turned around and left him sitting there. They would have taken him physically out of that classroom into an unmarked car and got him the hell away from there to an undisclosed location. But what did they do? They left the school just like, hey, taking a stroll in the park, not a care in the world. It's like he knew that he wasn't going to be targeted. And I find it very, very telling that on the morning of 9/11, when the planes hit the towers, at the same time this military exercise was going on, dealing or training, learning, responding to what the same exact thing that was really taking place. In downtown Manhattan, the Carlyle Group was meeting. And George H.W. Bush, being a member of the Carlyle Group, was sitting next to his friend and business associate, Salam bin Laden, the brother of Osama bin Laden. Yes. For those of you that do not know that, that is a fact. George H.W. Bush was sitting next to his friend and business associate of many, many years, Salam bin Laden, on the morning of 9/11 when 3,000 people were murdered by supposedly by terrorists. And the mastermind that was just, you know, miraculously, wow, found and, you know, okay, he did it. Osama bin Laden, Salam bin Laden's brother. The bin Laden family and the Bush family, they go back many, many years and many business dealings. And if you remember, when all planes were grounded, the only people that were allowed to fly was the bin Laden family. Very strange. Very strange. If you don't know what's going on. Even stranger than that, Osama bin Laden is named the mastermind, and we're going to get revenge. We're going to clean his clock, and we attack Iraq. What the hell? What? You're going to you attack Iraq? Well, yeah, weapons of mass destruction. Weapons of mass destruction. Weapons of mass destruction. George W. Bush, Bill Cheney, Donald Rumsfeld, they repeated that so many times. Blah, blah, blah. Weapons of mass destruction. Were there weapons of mass destruction? No. Were there... Did that result in the deaths of 200,000 Iraqi men, women, children? Yes. And then when no weapons of mass destruction were found, and they're confronted with that fact, you know, Bush, Cheney, and Rumsfeld, they, well, you know, we thought there were. I mean, hell, everybody makes a mistake. Yes, everyone makes a mistake, but not a mistake that that costs 200,000 plus people, men, women, and children, their lives. That destroys a country. Literally destroys a country, a people. And right is right and wrong is wrong, and that is wrong. I don't care who you are, I don't care where, what country you're from, that's wrong. Okay, so on the morning of 9/11, a military exercise is taking place to train for that very thing that really took place. Okay. How many of you have heard of Event 201 that was held October 18th, 2019, 6 weeks before the coronavirus outbreak? 6 weeks before the coronavirus was named and, you know, is now a pandemic. On October 18th, 2019, last year, the event 201 pandemic exercise held by the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation was a high-level pandemic exercise in New York City, New York. Okay. The Johns Hopkins Center for Health Security, in partnership with the World Economic Forum and Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, hosted Event 201, a high-level pandemic exercise on October 18, 2019 in New York, New York. The exercise illustrated areas where public-private partnerships will be necessary during the response to a severe pandemic in order to diminish large-scale economic and social consequences. In recent years, the world has seen a growing number of epidemic events, amounting to approximately 200 events annually. These events are increasing, and they are disruptive to health, economies, and society. Managing these events already strains global capacity, even absent a pandemic threat. Experts agree that it is only a matter of time before one of these epidemics becomes global, a pandemic with potentially catastrophic consequences. A severe pandemic, which becomes Event 201, would require reliable cooperation among several industries, national governments, and key international institutions. Now, Jacob, you say, I've seen that video. I'm pretty sure I saw it on TV when it was happening. Yes, okay. You can look it up on YouTube. It was a 5-hour event, a 5-hour mock training. And I mean, when I say mock, I mean these people that participated, great acting. I mean, they played their parts very, very well. Down to a T. I mean, to the letter. Okay. And what this was, they were talking about things such as, now get this, talking about things such as, there's this man that's playing some, you know, senator, representative, a member of the GOV. And he says, okay, what are we going to do about the social media and the people that are posting fake news or, you know, fear propaganda? Okay, when it's said by someone like him, you know, if this was actually happening, and it was, you know, someone, a politician, when it's said by someone like him, chances are they're not promulgating fake news or telling the truth. And, you know, people, you know, they're blaming, they're putting blame where blame is due, or possibly due, and saying, okay, this was planned. And he says in this, you know, video, this Event 201, he says, we need to enact laws and punishments for people that post things of, you know, such nature on social media. And, you know, goes on to say, you know, take them off of social media and even arrest them and hold them or imprison them. That's where I believe
that this is headed is just like the event, the training, the mock exercise, whatever. I can really see that. Many people, they don't know this, but if you believe in conspiracy theories, even one, if you believe if you question the official story of 9/11, if you question that Oswald assassinated Kennedy by himself and himself alone, if you question any of that, did you know that you are viewed by the GOV as a potential domestic terrorist? I kid you not. And your name, your information, is placed on a list. You're listed as a conspiracy nut, or, you know, basically not a nut, basically, okay, we got a problem here, boys. Shane, you know, he talks about conspiracy theories and a lot more, and he's basically insulted the former president of the United States, George H.W. Bush and George W. Bush, and about how one was not such a nice guy, and the other was didn't have the mental capacity to really be a bad guy. I just did it again, didn't I? Look, I'm not doing this to win friends and influence people. I'm doing this to hopefully get people to think for themselves rather than have I'm just going to go ahead and say it. Rather than have the government think for you, or religion to think for you. Because let me tell you, if you don't think for yourself, they're happy to do it for you. Always. Religion is just as guilty in a problem as much as government. Okay? What both do is they tell you what you believe, and then they reward you for believing it. You see how that works? Now, what do is, it's a psyop. It's a mental trick. I mean, it's very, very smooth, very coordinated. They tell you you're free. You're free. The land of the free and home of the brave. I'm not discounting the bravery part one bit, but freedom? Are we free? We're not free. I mean, we have liberty, correct? But that's not freedom. Liberty is something that a sailor gets when when he's off the ship. But if he was free, he wouldn't have to come back to the ship after liberty, right? But he's on liberty, so what is liberty? It is temporary. It is not freedom. And some people, they believe that liberty and freedom are synonymous, and they're not. And I find it very telling that, you know, people talk about the Statue of Liberty and that that's the beacon of freedom, and that when immigrants came here, they saw the Statue of Liberty and they were just overwhelmed with this emblem, this symbol of freedom, and how beautiful it was and how beautiful it still is. And I'm not disputing that. I mean, I think it's a beautiful statue. But how many of you know that is talking about that is a symbol of liberty, not freedom? That is a symbol of liberty, not freedom. Proof of that is if you look at the entire statue, you'll see that Lady Liberty's ankle, she's wearing something that is not an ankle bracelet. It's a shackle. And attached to that shackle is a chain. And that chain goes, I believe it goes down into the foundation of the statue itself. And what does that tell you? That is liberty, not freedom. If it was freedom, there would be no shackle around her ankle. There would be no chain holding her there. She would be free to do as she pleased, you know, but that's very, very telling. And a lot of people, they don't get that. They don't see that because it's just not, it's not really talked about. What is talked about is, look at her crown, look at the face, look at the entire picture, look at the entirety of anything, not just certain parts. Look at everything from every angle. You'll be surprised at what you see. Okay, I'm going to talk more about this event 201. It goes on to say that there is a world need for new partnerships to diminish large-scale economic and societal consequences of pandemics. What is that really saying? It's saying that the world needs new business partnerships to diminish large-scale economic and societal consequences of pandemics. What does that mean? They lose money. It's all about the money. That's what they're concerned about. They're not concerned about the people that are dying. They're concerned about losing money. So they have to make new ways, new partnerships, you know, hit it at a different angle to make money, like with pandemics, who's profiting? I mean, who's really, while small businesses and just about every other business is closing or can't run their business, what business is booming? The healthcare industry, the medical industry. It's crazy. The pharmaceutical industry, booming. But it's very, very sad because the small business owner, the mom and pop shops, those who have built, worked, and made themselves successful, maybe in their small town or their community. What happens? What happens when you have a social distancing and you can't have more than 10 people meeting within a group, such as here in Texas right now? What happens? It's a showstopper. It is a showstopper, and it does stop the show, and it stops the flow. It stops the flow of money. It stops the flow of everything. With that being said, this is from the Center for HealthSecurity.org, the event 201. You can look it up, and I will put that up in just a minute. Center for HealthSecurity.org, the event 201. You can look it up. You can watch the whole thing, but this is just video titles. Segment 1, intro and medical countermeasures discussion. Segment 2, trade and travel discussion. Segment 3, finance discussion. Segment 4, communications discussion and epilogue video. Segment 5, hot wash and conclusion. Okay. Media coverage. Bloomberg. Event 201, preparing for a pandemic. Homeland preparedness news. Public-private cooperation must improve to fill gaps in pandemic preparation response. And it just goes on and on and on. And this backstory to this exercise says that a disease called the coronavirus. But not just the coronavirus, the Wuhan coronavirus. That's right. 6 weeks before this happened, this exercise, this pandemic exercise called the pandemic virus, the coronavirus, a coronavirus, but not just that, the Wuhan coronavirus. Where did the real virus outbreak take place? Wuhan. In the training, in the mock event 201, It was said to have started in pigs. In pigs that were being kept for, you know, food purposes, being such as the real story, you know, the meat markets, the, you know, fish markets or whatever, where people go and buy and sell, you know, meat. Yeah, the Wuhan coronavirus began in pigs in Wuhan, China. Same thing. I mean, it's like these people can read the future. What people? Well, you know, people like Bill and Melinda Gates. And Bill Gates did a TED Talk back in, I believe it was 2015, maybe 2016, and he said we are not ready for another, for the next pandemic, for the next outbreak. And you know what? He was right. But ask yourself, why was he right? Why would he say that? Why would Bill Gates give a TED Talk on how we are not prepared for the next pandemic, the next global pandemic? Okay, remember, this was in 2015, 2016. He doesn't sponsor. He's not a part of Event 201 until, what, 5 months ago? So tell me, how could he be the authority and speak on a pandemic? I mean, correct me if I'm wrong, but is Bill Gates someone that really has the knowledge and authority to speak on anything medical? I mean, health, biological. I mean, does he have the authority, does he have the knowledge to speak on a viral pandemic? I don't believe so. Question is why did he? And it's my belief, my opinion, is that he didn't have the knowledge, but people that he knows, people that he's connected to, they damn sure had the knowledge. And they're not going to get up and show their face, but they tell him what to say, because after all, he's Bill Gates. And he gets up and he says it, and like I said, he was right. We weren't ready, and we aren't ready. Truth is when you look, I'm a people reader. I can look at someone and I've you know, been able to, you know, do this my entire life, and it's used to be most of my life it was a curse more than a blessing, truthfully. I mean, sometimes it would be nice not to know even part of how, you know, someone really feels or what they're really thinking. I'm not saying I'm a mind reader, but I can read people. I can read people in person. I can read people, believe it or not, by a picture. This is, you know, something I can't even explain, but there's many people that will back that up and, you know, tell you, yeah, you know, I mean, that's the truth. I mean, as weird as it seems. But watch the people. Watch the powers that be. Watch the warriors. Look at their faces. Tell me what you see. Tell me what you see now. Just you know, thinking about how they look. Even the president. I'm just going to say Mr. T. How does he look? Now, here's a man who is the boss. Even before he was president, the boss. I mean, he does not lose, correct? I mean, he has that mentality. He wins at all costs. I mean, you know, it's all about winning, and he doesn't back down, and nothing, you know, nothing gets to him. He gets to everything else, kind of like Chuck Norris, you know. yeah. It's like, you know, Chuck Norris calls your house. He didn't call the wrong number. You answered the wrong phone, you know, or something like that. Anyway, but tell me what you see on his face. Tell me what you see on the vice president's face. On all their faces. I'll tell you what I see. I see it's really sad because I don't see people that really have a plan. They're trying, but my personal belief is that they're as much in the dark about this as everyone else. The and I forget his name, but he's the little short guy with the round glasses, the expert that is trying to bring some knowledge to this this nightmare. You know, we have, you know, President Trump up. And you're saying things like, well, we are expecting a vaccine to be ready in 3 to 4 months. And this doctor, you can see him in the background, he just puts his palm over his face and he's just like shaking his head. No, he just, you know, he could not believe that was said. I mean, it was just, you know, he was so shocked that, you know, you could just see it. It's like, oh my God, I cannot believe he just said that. So he has to correct him, and I don't know if, I doubt he did it publicly, but he told him, He said, look, he said, there is no vaccine that is going to be, he says, even if we had a vaccine developed, he said, it would be, like 18 months would be a year and a half before it would be. And, it's like, well, that was a truthful answer, but it wasn't one that was liked. Well, so be it. And that's just it, is this, this man, you know, said that, okay, Nitro, you said there's this sound of blowing wind in the background. Let me check on something real quick. Sorry about that. I believe the air just came on, and hold on, I'll be right back in 20 seconds. Okay, that noise should go away pretty soon, within the next minute or so. Mr. You say, I see that they are lost. Well, right. Me too. And I see that there's a certain amount of anxiety, there's a certain amount of fear there too. I mean, who wouldn't be scared? I mean, we're talking, you know, this is big time. That's when you say British Prime Minister told the people to prepare themselves to say goodbye to their loved ones. Whoa, I didn't know that. Okay, you say the British Prime Minister told people to prepare themselves to say goodbye to their loved ones. Okay, wow, can you explain that? I mean, what the context is he, you know, basically telling them that to say goodbye because everyone's going to die? I mean, I hope not, but, wow, that is, it's horrible. I mean, but let me get back to the event 201, and I just want to touch on some key things here. Okay, let's see. All right. Yes, that's really, it's really horrible. I mean, even if, you know, you, let's just say that you know that everyone is going to die. Well, the last thing I would do is to tell people to prepare themselves. Listen, I was a funeral director in Balmer for, you know, I was in the funeral industry for 20 plus years. You can tell people all day long to prepare themselves because, you know, grandma's going to die or, you know, mom's going to die or dad's going to die or whatever. And despite your best efforts and their best efforts, guess what? You're never prepared. You're never prepared. When it happens, it's like you know, ripping a scab off of a wound or ripping the stitches out of a laceration. I mean, yeah, you're never prepared to say goodbye to their loved one. Oh my God. Whoa. I need to talk to this guy. Man, he needs some bedside manners. Whoa. It's like, with prime minister like that, who needs enemies? Whoa. Man, that's hardcore. Okay. Now, this is an article from the Times of Israel, blogs.timesofisrael.com. Christina Lynn, okay, L-I-N, Christina Lynn. Now get this, this is, and I'm going to read this verbatim, stop, and we can discuss, you know, what's going on. And those of you that are listening and not taking part in the live chat, thank you for listening. I appreciate you. Love and light to you. And my hope that you're all okay and that your families are okay, and that you make it through this, and they make it through this. You know, coming out on the other side smelling like a rose. I know that that's not possible, that's not going to happen for everyone, but I appreciate you. And although I don't know you, thank you for listening. I appreciate you. Want to give a quick, you know, shout out to new listeners in Pakistan, Ecuador, Japan, and Guatemala, Ireland, and Scotland. Thank you for listening. I appreciate you. And as far as Scotland, I am Scottish for the most part. My great great grandfather owned a grocery store in Glasgow, and he immigrated to the United States in, I believe it was 1790 something. My father has the has all of that, but anyway, thank you, my Scottish brothers and sisters, for listening. And my mother is part Irish and Welsh, so my Irish brothers and sisters and Welsh brothers and sisters, thank you so much for listening. Thank you, everybody. You're all my brothers and sisters. Pakistani, all of you. Love all of you. Thank you. Okay. Chinese virus, American plague, and bio-warfare narratives. The coronavirus crisis is heating up. The new Cold War between the United States and China. And again, this is from the blogs.timesofisrael.com. The blogs of Christina Lin, L-I-N. Okay. During a White House press briefing on Tuesday, President Trump called COVID-19 the Chinese virus and was reprimanded by a few journalists for its racial overtones, citing increasing reports of discrimination and abuse against Asian Americans. Trump defended his position as a counterpunch to Beijing floating the conspiracy theory that the United States military may have brought the virus to Wuhan, which in turn was China's counterpunch to the U.S. conspiracy theory that the virus was leaked from a Chinese lab. As the world is reeling from a global pandemic, instead of using this as common ground to forge cooperation for the betterment of humanity, it seems Beijing and Washington are playing the blame game and ratcheting up tensions in an already strained relationship. Okay, Nizrin, you say it was last week or maybe 10 days ago when the numbers in Italy were climbing. Okay, thank you. Thank you for sending that link. I appreciate it. The narrative of U.S. biowarfare. From Beijing's perspective, the grounds for its conspiracy theory are found in a February 29th Global Research article and a few others, which highlighted incidents that suggest the virus may be an act of biological warfare. One event is the Military World Games that took place in Wuhan between October 18th through the 27th, 2019, where a delegation of over 300 U.S. soldiers participated along with other soldiers from over 100 nations. Whoa! This is my first time reading this, okay? So what we have is we have the event 201 taking place October 18th, 2019. And what do we have taking place in Wuhan? Between October, 18th through the 27th of the same year, last year? The Military World Games, where a delegation of over 300 U.S. soldiers participated along with other soldiers from over 100 nations. 2 weeks later, the first COVID-19 case was discovered in Wuhan. Conspiracy theorists draw links between U.S. soldiers at the Wuhan military game, the sudden closure of the U.S. Army's biodefense lab at Fort Detrick due to safety lapse back in August 2019. Wow. I did not know that. Let me read that again, okay? One event is the Military World Games that took place in Wuhan between October 18th through the 27th, 2019, where a delegation of over 300 U.S. soldiers participated along with other soldiers from over 100 nations. 2 weeks later, the first COVID-19 case was discovered in Wuhan. Conspiracy theorists draw links between U.S. soldiers at the Wuhan military game to the sudden closure of U.S. Army's biodefense lab at Fort Detrick due to safety lapse back in August 2019. Whoa. Another event occurred on the same day that the Wuhan military game opened. On October 18th, the Johns Hopkins Center for Health Security convened a coronavirus pandemic table tabletop exercise called Event 201. By coincidence, the scenario simulates an outbreak of a novel zoonotic coronavirus transmitted from bats to pigs to people and eventually becomes transmissible from person to person, which led to a severe pandemic. Sponsored by Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, the World Economic Forum, with players including current and former officials from the CIA, the World Bank, IMF, pharmaceutical and public relations firms, the eerie timing of a coronavirus simulation a few weeks before the outbreak in Wuhan not only provoked conspiracy theories from the Chinese, but also others suspicious of Big Pharma U.S. government collusion. Let me tell you something. And again, this is just my opinion. When she says the eerie timing of a coronavirus simulation a few weeks before the outbreak in Wuhan not only provoked conspiracy theories from the Chinese, but also others suspicious of Big Pharma U.S. government collusion. Conspiracy? Conspiracy theories? How about, how would this fare in a court of law with a jury, with an impartial jury? The evidence. You think we could make a conviction? I mean, do you think we could get a conviction on China, United States? Let's just keep pushing and let's see where this takes us. Now, we're at two hours, but since this is special, this is an extraordinary event, a global crisis. So I'll keep going as long as there's at least one person that's listening. So anyway, moreover, it did not help that a coronavirus plush toy was used as an image to promote the event and given away as a souvenir, seemingly making light of a deadly virus, prompting comments from Twitter and Facebook of Big Pharma conspiracy. And it's a very cute, I guess you could say, it looks like a cookie or a orange sun. It has the little red protrusions going around it, very much like sun rays, but they're red. And it has two black eyes, just dull or shiny black eyes in the middle. Okay, and so it's this is a Twitter post. Says nobody has been able to explain why they gave out stuffed souvenir coronavirus toys at Event 201, yet almost like this is big fun for them. Or maybe it's to commemorate the virus that will make them a fortune on vaccines and other treatments we will be forced to buy. What are your thoughts? Is what the Twitter post says. And Christina Lynn goes on to say, narrative of Chinese biowarfare. From Washington's perspective, the conspiracy began from a January 29th Washington Times article that the virus outbreak could be linked to Wuhan Institute of Viral Studies. It cited an Israeli intelligence officer, Danny Shom, for this claim, which was later picked up by other sites and promoted by U.S. government officials such as Senator Tom Cotton and some members of the Committee on Present Danger China, CPDC. It is the sort of tale that resonates China hawks in Washington, while others, such as Senator John Cornyn, expressed disdain for Chinese people and culture, saying, "A culture where people eat bats and snakes and dogs and things like that are to blame for the coronavirus." Wow. Wow. Thanks, John Cornyn. That's great. Why do all these people have to be from Texas? I'm kidding. I'm not kidding about John Cornyn being... That is just wrong. It does not show a very high intelligence there, does it? More, his IQ is probably his shoe size. I mean, wow. Anyway. These viruses are transmitted from the animal to people, and that's why China has been the source of a lot of these viruses, like SARS, Cornyn says, like MRSA, the swine flu, and now the coronavirus. So I think they have a fundamental problem, Cornyn said to reporters, and that he did not object to the name, the Chinese virus. Though he seemed unaware that MERS, Middle East Respiratory Syndrome, originated in Saudi Arabia, and swine flu, H1N1, in the U.S. in 2009. See what I was talking about, his IQ? yeah. This guy is a joke. Anyway, other members of Congress piled on and are now demanding that China pay reparation to the United States. Representative Jim Banks of Indiana suggested the president could force China to relieve a great deal of American debt, given China holds $1.1 trillion in U.S. Treasury bonds, or he could institute tariffs on China and designate the funds into a coronavirus victim relief fund for Americans. How do you think that would work out? I mean, really, how do you think that would work out? How things like that worked out in the past? Well, I'll give you a little hint. They haven't worked out. They haven't worked out. Why? Well, yeah, that $1.1 trillion would somehow, some way, all disappear, or three quarters of it would disappear. Or there would be some excuse. Well, it was, you know, we had to pay for this, we had to pay for that. You're talking about $1.1 trillion. Okay, I'm done. Anyway, back in 2009, there were no mentions of reparations from foreign countries when the U.S. swine flu infected over 60 million Americans and then spread globally with death tolls over 570,000. But if President Trump does seek reparation, this could set an interesting precedent for future pandemic outbreaks. Unfortunately, the right-wing media outlets fanning anger and Beijing's heavy-handed censorship unwittingly gives conspiracy theorists a boost. This is risking a complete fracture of bilateral relations and impending global cooperation to tackle the pandemic. The Chinese virus and emerging American plague. At this critical window, U.S. and Chinese leaders would be wise to redeem the time and exercise joint leadership to address the pandemic rather than trading barbs and pointing fingers, because another imminent threat worse than the Chinese virus is brewing in Los Angeles. Now, this is something that I read about 2 weeks ago, and it's really frightening by itself, but really, really frightening if you add it to the coronavirus. She says, because another imminent threat, worse than the Chinese virus, is brewing, or worse than the coronavirus, is brewing in Los Angeles, the American plague of Black Death. That's right. The bubonic plague in Los Angeles. And how is the bubonic plague transmitted? What's the carriers? For a long time, people thought it was rats, but it was the fleas on the rats. What is taking place in Los Angeles? In Los Angeles, you have the homeless problem. Huge homeless problem, where they are living in living in tent cities, and their trash is not picked up. Their waste, human waste, is not picked up. So therefore, you have their trash, you have the human waste. It is a nightmare, and from the videos that I've seen, you can see rats running across the wherever. I mean, they're running everywhere. And some of these rats are the size of a damn dog. I mean, like a chihuahua. Looks to me like at least a chihuahua puppy. And I'm like, whoa, is that a rat or is that a rat? Personally, I would be up in a tree no matter what size the rat was. I can handle snakes. I could handle a rhinoceros, but a rat, something about a rat that just gives me the willies. I cannot stand even thinking about a rat. Just nasty. I guess because, you know, my worst fear is it running up my pants leg or something, you know. Because let me tell you, you really want to see some, you really want to see a 51-year-old man shuck his pants, buddy, let a rat crawl up my pants leg, I will be streaking. Yeah, no doubt about it. Yeah, I will make sure there is no rat on my person. So, woof. Okay, moving on. Since the early 2019 typhus outbreak in Los Angeles, public health officials have been sounding the alarm about the rise of medieval diseases in homeless encampments with the unsheltered population numbering more than 30,000. This population is at risk of being incubators of not just the coronavirus, but also typhus, typhoid fever, tuberculosis, and the bubonic plague. Well, back in 2000, I believe it was 2013, they had a tuberculosis outbreak. And I talked about that on the shows I did about Elisa Lam that was found in the water tank on top of the Cecil Hotel. 22-year-old Canadian college student, Lisa Lam. And just by, you know, not by coincidence, I don't believe, the tuberculosis test kits that were issued in Los Angeles on Skid Row, the name of those test kits were Lam Elisa. Her name just last name first. Very, 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 very interesting. Okay. It says the plague is already found on fleas in the out-of-control rat population in downtown Los Angeles, which thrives on the trash, food, and human excrement littering the sidewalks. And in 2018, a United Nations rapporteur actually produced a damning report of the deplorable conditions of the homeless encampments. Subsequently, doctors have repeatedly issued grave warnings that the entire California population may be at risk if the problem is not mitigated, but to no avail. In light of this emergency, and while it may be politically expedient to scapegoat one another during election year, now is not the right time when so much global public health and lives are at stake. Both U.S. and China need to set aside their pride and come together not to just solve the current coronavirus, but more importantly, set conditions to prevent the emerging American plague, the Black Plague, looming over the horizon, which is the bubonic plague. So, that is very shocking. Just, wow. I can't, that's crazy. I mean, 300 U.S. soldiers were in Wuhan on October 18th through October 27th, and before that, Fort Detrick viral lab shuts down. Wow. Okay. My main questions, my main concern is this is really moving so quickly. I mean, it's just absolutely mind-boggling how fast this is being transmitted, how fast it's being spread. And I have said that it is almost like, I'm just, you know, saying this. It's my opinion. This is not, don't take this as fact, but I'm just putting it out there. It's almost like that this virus is evolving, that it's not yet what it's going to be. And what I mean by that is instead of slowing down, even with the social distancing, the lockdowns and everything, this thing's really, really aggressive and very, very powerful. I mean, it's wow. And it's like if this is in fact biological warfare, and this coronavirus, say it was just the coronavirus, but it was tampered with, it was somehow changed, or, you know, manually mutated, I guess. I'm not sure if that's the correct term, but, or it was, you know, hell, I mean, we have nanotechnology now. Who knows? I mean, but let's just say that it was developed, okay, and that, so, you know, you're thinking, okay, this is biological, what? Warfare. Say, so you create let's say that you're the biologist, you're the biowarfare expert. You create the coronavirus, COVID-19, and you're done, right? Okay. In my mind, the way I think is, okay, what would I do if I was in that position? If I wanted to, I'm not saying I do or I ever would, because I don't. But if I am putting myself in the shoes, in the mindset of someone that wants to spread a pandemic, a horrible pandemic, global, and just decimate everyone, you know, just affect them. If they don't die, they're going to die in other ways. Financially, emotionally, mentally, I mean, you know. Okay, let's say that I create the COVID-19. And I get my patient zero or whatever, and send them out, and boom, there I have it. The only thing about that is a person with that mindset, they're going to say, or they're going to think to themselves, okay, well, when they find a cure or they find a vaccine for it, then my COVID-19 coronavirus is done, right? So, as unpopular and frightening as this sounds or is, have we considered that the COVID-19 could possibly be one of, say, 5 different strains, 10 different strains, 15 different strains. Very similar, but also very different as far as you find and develop a vaccine for the COVID-19, and guess what? Yeah, didn't count on having 4 more strains or 4 more different viruses to deal with, which would mean that there would have to be vaccines, I suppose, for each one. Now, depending on how much different they were, that would certainly be I can't even imagine. But like I said, I'm just placing myself in that mindset of someone that wants to spread a pandemic and basically take out everybody and everything. I doubt very, very seriously that they would just create one and be done with it. I would think several. Several. So, anyway, if you have any questions, of course I can't see who's
who's listening, I can't see, the only person I see on the chat is Nazreen. If there's anybody else on the chat or that's listening, that if you want to ask a question or questions, please do so now. I'm not saying that I have the answer, but if I can answer it, answer your question, I certainly will. If I can't, I will try to find someone who can. So, Nazreen, do you have any questions, comments? And while I'm waiting, I just want to thank each and every one that listened, that took part in the live chat. I want to thank and appreciate all of my listeners. And please, you know, those of you that listen on a regular basis or semi-regular basis, that enjoy the show, please you follow me or the show on Spreaker, and that is www.spreaker.com/show/the-texorcist. And please, I would appreciate this so much if you would go to my YouTube channel, The Texorcist Live, and you follow me there, because I'm at 251 followers. YouTube changed their rules, and I would actually be doing live videos on YouTube, but they say now that the only channels that can do that are channels who have 1,000 listeners or more. So I'm already over a quarter of the way there. If you would, please, follow me there on YouTube. You know, truth is, even if you don't like the show, would you please just follow me? I mean, I don't want your money. I don't ask for money. I don't need your money. I don't ask for anything. But please, if you enjoy the show and you like the content and what I present, please follow me on the YouTube channel. I would appreciate that so much. I'll dance at all of your next weddings. Anyway, if you want to contact me, you can contact me at thetexorcistpodcast@gmail.com. That's thetexorcistpodcast@gmail.com. And if you want to send me a message or contact me about the show, a show I've done, or a show that you would like to hear, please contact me. Or if you would like to share your personal experience of, you know, something that you've gone through, something that you've experienced, please contact me and let's talk. Anyway, sending you love and light in the midst of this coronavirus pandemic and the curfews and the lockdowns and the quarantines, and you know, it seems like that everyone's isolated and everything, and that's why that I do these live shows is mainly for, you know, people that
that are introverts. They don't get out much. And they, you know, that you know, really hurts me, you know, touches me, because at one time I was that way and rarely ever left home, worked from home, never left home, and basically secluded myself like Howard Hughes. And, you know, there's a, well, not at the moment, but there's so much that to experience, and, I know myself for the longest time, I didn't want to admit it, but I'm not afraid to admit it now. I was afraid. Staying home, secluding myself was much better than taking the chance of being rejected or not liked. And if you've listened to the shows I've done, like the last four shows I've done about the activation of the pineal gland, let me tell you, now, you know, the truth is, when I walk into a crowded room or a party, I'm not worried about if they don't like me. My thought now is, seriously, I don't even think about it because I don't give a damn whether they like me or not. I am me. I'm going to be me. And as long as I'm not hurting anyone, as long as I'm not, you know, emotionally, physically, psychologically hurting another person or living being, then, hey, you can like me or you can leave me. I don't give a damn either way. I am me and I am free. And let me tell you, there is power in that. So, with that being said, love and light to you all. Love you all. Good night from Texas. See you tomorrow night at 9 p.m. Central. Good night, everybody.